Hi, this is Tim Kaiser. Welcome back to Sola Melodica, where we review and reflect on music lyrically, looking for a glimmer of God and redemption in song lyrics. So today we're going to do a song called God is Dead by Black Sabbath. Actually, I'm going to do like a whole Black Sabbath series. I'm going to kind of go work my way backwards. God is Dead was on their album 13. I'm gonna go backwards through some of the other things, get through Ian Gillan, Tony Martin, Dio, and then back again to Ozzy from the 1.0 version of Black Sabbath before Dio came in. So this should be interesting. Let's get right into it. Thank you for joining me today. Before the lyrics actually start, I just wanted to comment. This song is reminiscent of their really old stuff, in my opinion, at least. I think Black Sabbath was really slow and brooding, and I'm sure it was it's going to change tempo a couple times because that's classic Black Sabbath mode of operandi, so to speak. But yeah, this is reminiscent of the old stuff. And before we get too far into it, let's just go back. The whole concept between God is Dead was actually plucked from a quote from Friedrich Nietzsche, a philosopher. He had mentioned that God is dead, and it kind of gained traction in the 18, probably 18, 1900s. And then now Ozzy and team are writing a song about it.
Lost in the darkness.
Let's catch up with some of these lyrics. Starting off quite strong, in my opinion. Lost in the darkness, I faith in the light. Faith of my father, my brother, my maker and savior, help me make it through the night. So first off, the faith of my father, my brother. He doesn't say anybody else, but I hear a lot of people talk about that. I'm such and such a type of faith because that's how I was raised. We need to get deeper than that. Faith, our faith in God, has to be real to us. We can't ride on the coattails of our grandparents or our parents or our brother or wife or husband. Man, you got to make it real. It's got to be real in you. Blood on my conscience and murder in mind. You know, we all were, I know we think we're good, but we're not, right? We're all born in sin, right? We're going to have blood on our conscience and murder in mind because we are capable of doing pretty awful things. If you take a peek around you, man, stuff's happening all the time. And that is the sin in our heart. The result of the sin in our heart is sins, murder, theft, you know, rioting, blowing buildings up, all that stuff. It all originates from that sin. Out of the gloom I rise up from my tomb into impending doom. Now my body is my shrine. I love the way those lyrics are put together. That the pace and the tempo, fantastic. Blood runs free, the rain turns red. Give me the wine, you keep the bread. So those of you who are familiar with what's called the Lord's Table or communion, there's two elements, right? Two elements. The blood and the bread, right? The wine and the bread, the blood and the body. And here, the author, I'm not sure if it's Ozzy or Tony or Geezer or whoever, if you know who wrote the song, please put it in the comments. He's saying, give me the wine, you keep the bread. So he's only wanting 50-50. And ironically, this during the Reformation, back in the 1500s, you know, Martin Luther, when he did his thing, that was one of the things that the normal people, like you and me, we could not get the wine. Right, we couldn't take the wine in communion. We only get the half of it. And here he's saying, "Give me the wine." But the wine speaks of the cleansing, the atoning power of what Christ did for us. The bread is speaking of the body of Christ, the church. It's more of the commitment. And he's like, "Yeah, I'll take the good stuff, but I don't want the commitment." In churches that teach or proclaim, "Oh, you can live however you want. God just loves you the way you are." It's kind of true, but not really. God requires everything from us. He does not take half-committed, half-hearted Christians. And those of us, or those of you who think that's the case, you're probably going to be in for a rude awakening because he'll say something like, probably the scariest verse in the Bible is when he says, "Depart from me, I never knew you." Right? That's pretty scary. Then voices echo in my head, "Is God alive or is God dead? Is God dead?" So he's got these thoughts, right? And my wife's been sharing with me lately the difference between doubt and unbelief. Doubt, you know, we're gonna have doubts, and perhaps the writer was observing society and seeing crazy things happening. It's like, you know, people say, "Well, if there really was a God, would He allow X, Y, and Z to happen?" So it's kind of it's just a thought, and it starts. And hey, you know, questions are okay. Questions are okay, right? And there are answers. Let's keep going. It's gonna pick up, I believe. It's gonna pick up, and we have some territory to cover here. Rivers of evil run through dying land, swimming in sorrow. They kill, steal, and borrow. There is no tomorrow, for the sinners will be damned. Ashes to ashes, you can't exhume a soul. Fantastic line. Who do you trust when corruption and lust, creed of all the unjust, leaves you empty and unwhole? So here again, he's talking about just things going around all around him. You know, there's rivers of evil going through dying land, and sorrow and killing and stealing, and you know, people dying because there's no tomorrow. Ashes to ashes, you can't exhume a soul. I'm not sure what that means, but I love that line. Who do you trust? When corruption, lust. So here he's talking about, okay, now can he trust? I think he's leaning towards the spiritual community, the church. Who can you trust when corruption and lust, creed of all the unjust, leaves you empty and whole? And he's asking, you know? And then he goes on to safeguard by philosophy. Often, you know, we have, you know, don't bother me with facts. My mind is made up. So he's like, he's safeguarding his philosophy until his dying breath, transfer reality into a living death. So, he's searching. He's searching and seeking for truth. And he's wanting an answer. He's like, when will this nightmare be over? I mean, I need to know. Fantastic lyrics. So let's catch up some more. Nowhere to run, nowhere to hide. Wondering if we'll meet again on the other side. I'm assuming he means heaven, or I guess hell. I don't know. It could be asking that question. Do you believe a word that the good book said, or is it just a fairy tale and God is dead? So that's common right now in our society. People are like, oh, the Bible was just, it's written by men and it's fallible. You know, that's personally, I believe that's a real lazy academic answer. It means people are not doing the hard work of verifying it. They're taking a bumper sticker slogan and just running with it. When in truth, I mean, there's a whole science of study where people take manuscripts and they verify their authenticity, drawing a blank on what it is. If you know what that is, please put it in the comments and bail me out on this one. But the actual New Testament, there's almost 6,000 different portions of manuscripts, and this has been studied forever, right? And let me ask you a question. So if the Bible could be proved as inaccurate after it's been, you know, in society for these thousands of years, without a doubt it would have been done, because you know what, people actually hate the Bible. In a lot of places, it's illegal, and they can't prove anything that's saying it's not. It's a reliable source of historical documents. and it's proven over and over again. So there's a ton of good material out there. I think the Thinking podcast is awesome. Lisa Childers' podcast is awesome. These people are out there hitting it hard at least every week or a couple times a week on this, the authenticity of Scripture. And so I would encourage you to look at that. He's asking again, is God dead? He's curious. He's curious. So here the author is saying, you know what, the voices are still questioning. And again, doubt, we can answer doubts, right? You can find answers to doubts. He's observing, you know, that God is dead because a lot of crazy stuff is going on. And I get it, you know, I get it. But he says the blood pours down, the rain turns red. And he says, I don't believe that God is dead. So in the end, right, he doesn't believe it. He still has doubts. So let's go back. We started earlier with this, with the quote from Friedrich Nietzsche, who said God is dead. And that's all the people who hate God, basically they use that one quote. But let's read the quote in its entirety, or at least the big part of it, because I don't have the whole book in front of me, obviously. It said, God is dead. God remains dead. And we have killed him. How shall we comfort ourselves, the murderers of all murderers? What was holiest and mightiest of all that the world has yet owned has bled to death under our knives. Who will wipe this blood off us? What water is there for us to clean ourselves? What festivals of atonement? What sacred games shall we have to invent? Is not the greatness of this deed too great for us? Well, good news is God's not dead, right? He's alive. The Bible's alive. God's alive. Jesus is resurrected from the dead. This was a great psalm, and Black Sabbath, they provide some really challenging lyrics for this. This is a great opportunity for the next five songs we're going to do. If you found today helpful, beneficial, a blessing to you, do me a favor, like it, subscribe to the channel, share it with your friends, place some comments, and I'll be back again soon with another video, and we'll be Black Sabbath. Blessings to you and your family.